So I'm hanging out, listening to a little ABBA. That was a 70s supergroup from Sweden. Just so you know, if you're looking for some kind of feel-good music in the pandemic. So we're going to start on PowerPoint number 2 for Blood Spatter. Before we do that, I thought I'd give you a little tour of my downstairs bathroom because it's pretty exciting. The reason I want to show it to you is because I think you'll enjoy my toilet seat, which is obviously a blood spatter theme. So kind of terrifying for people who are first time visitors to me and, you know, don't know my personality, but yeah. Anyway, also have a Kleenex box of the Shining Twins and my hand. So, hey, how's it going? Maybe you touch your genitals. Liquid hand soap, because maybe you did. So, anywho, we are going to get started on PowerPoint number 2. Right, Boach? Walk over here. Okay, get this all lined up. Okay, so the last PowerPoint was kind of a basic introduction. And also how to do the calculations of origin of impact patterns. What I want to do in PowerPoint 2 is talk about some different types of patterns. You know, we talked about how impact spatter is by far the most common type of bloodstain pattern that's found at crime scenes, but lots of other patterns too. So that's what this PowerPoint is about. Okay, so one of the definitions that I went through last time, I talked about forward and back spatter. We see that in gunshots, especially, you know, when the person is somewhat up close. Keep in mind that blood, even blood cells are obviously very small, but they do have mass, and eventually gravity is going to bring them down. So I'd given the example before that, you know, if someone is a sniper and, you know, they're 500 yards away, you're not going to see back spatter on them, simply because gravity will bring that blood down eventually at some point. It's not going to travel that far. But if the person who's doing the shooting is up close and personal, yeah, there's a really good chance that you're going to see back spatter on that person's clothing. And then, of course, forward spatter is what is coming out and is projected away from the source of blood. This is an important point, okay? And this relates to one of the questions that's in your homework assignment. So, if the bullet does not exit the body, potentially you're not going to see any forward spatter coming from an exit wound. Okay, so if it's a through and through bullet wound, yep, then you're going to have spatter projected on, you know, the wall or whatever was behind that person. But if you don't see forward spatter from a gunshot wound at a scene, don't jump to some, you know, conspiracy theory that, oh, you know, the body must have been moved or the person cleaned up the crime scene. Probably what's happened is the bullet simply did not exit the body. There is no exit wound. We saw that in the LA County Coroner video where, you know, if you remember Ruben Hernandez, he was found at a scene. He had an entrance wound, but there was no exit wound. So you wouldn't see any forward spatter coming from that exit wound simply because there wasn't one. So keep that in mind. It doesn't mean that, oh, you know, the person was killed somewhere else and then they dumped the body, or, you know, normally it's very straightforward and there's no exit wound. So back spatter, remember, is affected by the location of the injury, the size of the wound created, and really the biggest thing is the distance between the victim and the muzzle of the gun. So, you know, if it's someone coming up behind someone, giving them, you know, a contact gunshot wound to the back of the head, yeah, that person is likely going to have back spatter on them from the victim. So here's another term that has to do with specifically with gunshot wounds. So the drawback effect is that not only can you see back spatter on the person who fired the gun, you know, potentially on their skin or on their clothing, but it also is likely to enter the muzzle of the gun. And lucky for us in forensic science, most people who go out and murder people aren't gun enthusiasts. They don't run home and then properly clean out their gun and, you know, take really good care of it. So as a DNA person, I've had a lot of success where you get a gun from the suspect and then you take a swab and you swab inside the muzzle of the gun. And guess what? There's the blood of the victim because simply they didn't think to clean it or that that could be a possibility. So we have a name for that and it's called the drawback effect. Also, the thing with weapons is a lot of them tend to be dark colored and they have very textured surfaces, especially on the grip. And it's possible for minute amounts of blood to make it into those little creases. And because blood, when it oxidizes, becomes a very dark rust color, a lot of times it's not apparent to the person who has the gun that there's any spatter on there. And when we do DNA, keep in mind, we need a blood stain that literally is about the size of a pinhead to be able to get a full DNA profile. So this last bullet point here, what does spatter on and in the muzzle of the gun tell you about the position? Simply that they had to be pretty close to the victim when that shot was fired. Okay, cast-off spatter. And I want to talk about this because probably later tonight or whenever I get these videos done and uploaded, there's going to be a video case study, and one of the cases specifically talks about cast-off spatter. So cast-off spatter is different from forward spatter and back spatter in that it's not coming from the actual blood source or from the person. It's actually coming from a blood-covered object. And normally, this is the weapon, okay? It's the knife, or it's the baseball bat, or whatever, or someone's fist. So you see cast-off spatter when a weapon or a fist is pulled back between blows. So as always, remember the blood-stained tails are going to point to the direction that the object was moving. And cast-off spatter is most commonly seen very high up, on ceilings, walls, or other objects that are in the path of movement. So I had shown you this slide in the previous one to show you the difference between forward spatter. Okay, so if this is the victim, so let's say this is the victim's head and that's the source of the blood, the forward spatter is what is projected out and away from the source of the blood. Back spatter is what goes and is projected back onto the person who's delivering the blows. And then cast off spatter, you have to have at least one blow because when the weapon first comes down, it doesn't have any blood on it, right? So you have to have a blood covered weapon. And then as it's pulled back between blows, that's when you see cast off stains. And so normally these are very high up. These are the kind of stains that you're most likely to see high up on walls and also on ceilings. But it's not coming from the actual person. It's coming from a blood covered, usually a weapon. So here's an example of cast-off spatter. This is a ceiling and this is a light fixture that you see right there. So this tells you a couple of things. First of all, that there are several blows here because when you look at the pattern, let's see, let me grab a pen. It's going to be the easiest way for me to print these out. Do, 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 do. So if you look here, I see different blows. I see one here, two, three, four, five, six. There's probably at least six blows there. So that means that that weapon is coming back, and then the person is being attacked again at least six or seven times. The other thing that this tells me is that this spatter was caused by something sharp and pointy, which could be a knife, could be some type of blade, could be something like an ice pick or a screwdriver. And that's because if you look at the pattern, let's look at this one down here, the drops are very small and they are in a very linear pattern, and it's basically a line, okay? It's a very narrow pattern. When you see that, that indicates that the weapon is something sharp and pointy, like a knife. Okay, so that's reiterated here, okay? So when you look at the type of pattern, if it's from something sharp and pointy, like a knife, you're gonna see small blood droplets, and the pattern is gonna be very linear, meaning that it's in basically in a line. Okay, if it's from something that's larger, say a baseball bat, piece of wood, even someone's fists, the stains themselves are gonna be larger, and the cast off pattern, it's not gonna be a straight line, it's gonna be much wider and thicker. The other thing about cast-off spatter is it can suggest whether the weapon was used by a right-handed or a left-handed person. Now, I've had this discussion with blood spatter experts that I've talked to, and they tell me that, you know, potentially, like, for example, okay, I'm going to turn this around. Okay, so for example, if I'm stabbing someone and I'm right-handed, every time I bring the knife back, it's going to go up and to the right, okay, because I'm right-handed. So what blood spatter experts have told me is that potentially you could get the same pattern from using your non-dominant hand. So, you know, you could be using your left hand. Here are my thoughts on that. I think that most crimes are committed as acts of impulse. They're not planned out. So if it's up and to the right of the victim, hey, you guys, I'm teaching. The corgis are at it again. So if it's up and to the right, I think you can trust that it's a right-handed person. Literally, if a person was so devious that they want to try to fool investigators, they would have to go to the gym, work out their non-dominant hand so it's really strong, and so they're able to stab someone to death, which takes a ton of energy. So I think most people are going to use their dominant hand. So, you know, if it's up and to the right of the victim, it's a right-handed person. If the spatter pattern is up and to the left, most likely it's a left-handed person. The other thing that becomes very important in cast-off spatter is that it can show the minimum number of blows that struck the victim, because each separate blow is going to have its own pattern. Okay, once again, if I go back to the light fixture, one, two, three, four, five. So each one of those strikes has its own linear pattern. And that becomes really important because remember that if you're striking someone again and again, that's premeditation, and then you can prove first degree murder with that. Okay, so we're up to about 14 minutes, so I'm going to stop the video there and get this uploaded, and then next video we'll continue with arterial spray. Okay, thank you.